Wow, good morning. Welcome to the First Christian Church. I appreciate you being here. Wow, it's been a whirlwind of activity. We had Thanksgiving Thursday, we had Black Friday, we had Digestion Saturday. Sunday I woke up, realized we've been married 23 years. Woo! Thank you. And tomorrow's Cyber Monday, you know, and the neatest thing though is God has put us here together. We're gonna sing and celebrate. We're even having a couple life-saving events at the end of this service. So God is good all the time, which coincidentally is what we're going to sing. So please stand and join in.
God is good all the time. He put a song of praise in this heart of mine. God is good all the time. Through the darkest night, His light will shine. God is good. God is good all the time. God is good all the time. He put a song of praise in this heart of mine. God is good all the time. Through the darkest night, His light will shine. God is good. God is good all the time. If you're walking through the valley and there are shadows all around, do not fear. He will guide you. He will keep you safe and sound. For He has promised to never leave you, won't forsake you. And His word is God is good all the time. He put a song of praise in this heart of mine. God is good all the time. Through the darkest night, His light will shine. God is good. God is good all the time. We know sinners so unworthy. Stood for us, chose to die. Fill us with His Holy Spirit, where we can stand and testify that His love is everlasting and His mercies, they will never end. God is good all the time. He put a song of praise in this heart of mine. God is good all the time.
Can ever ask for or imagine. He does everything by His power that is working in us. Give Him glory in the church and in Christ Jesus. Give Him glory through all time and forever and ever. Amen.
He will never fail. He is almighty.
Give thanks, Lord, that by your power you've called us, you've justified us, you are remaking us in your image, and you intend to finish in us what you began. We give thanks this day, God, that we can worship you now for all of your goodness and for your power. Would you have your way among us again? Take our lives, God, and in any way that we would resist, we pray that today, at this moment of worship, we would humble ourselves and surrender again. We're grateful for your love that draws us in. We worship you now in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Kids, you're invited to follow Ryan to Kids Church. That begins now, so have a great time. To the rest of us, happy Advent. It's the first Sunday of Advent, and we're glad we're all together worshiping God on this initiation into 2016 Advent. To start our prayer offering this morning to the Father, from his word, I read 1 Peter 3, verse 9. When someone does something bad to you, do not do the same thing to him. When someone talks about you, do not talk about him. Instead, pray that good will come to him. You were called to do this so you might receive good things from God. The natural human tendency that God's trying to undo in us is when we're harmed to focus on the harm and to focus on retribution. However, in prayer, the work that God's trying to do in us, if we'll open ourselves to that, is to have God's point of view, God's mind and heart set, that I, God, can bring something good out of this if you'll cooperate with me and let me. So prayer can, if we allow it to, get our hearts and minds aligned to see hard things in life that we all face fairly frequently, as God sees them, and we can cooperate with God to let him bring the good out of those hard things that he will and he can. What would you have to add to our prayer offering this morning? What was his name? Sorry. We'll pray. Bobby.
Doug, I thank God that George is not at peace, but please pray for his children. They're having a really bad time. Mm-hmm. Appreciate it.
We will, Bobby. And we'll pray for you. Thank you. It's Judy. Join you in thanking God for that. Yes. Louise? Who had a prayer?
We need to say prayer for the jury.
What was the surname? Jerry who?
Jerry Slavin.
Slavin? Sure will. Do you know his first name? Okay. Okay. All right. Okay. I'll give voice to the prayer if you'll join your hearts and minds together. Father God, thank you for your work in us when we open ourselves up, you'll get us a heart set and a mindset that sees things the way you do, and open up for us the opportunity to cooperate with you to bring good out of hard things. Thank you for your proven power and influence to do that, and help us, we pray, to let you, to not get in your way, to not focus on retribution, to not focus on getting even, but to focus on the good that can come of the hard stuff. Thank you for that. Father, we mourn with those who mourn and pray to come alongside to lighten the load for Bobby and George's kids as they mourn his passing, and as they try to make arrangements and sort out all of the things that accompany a death. And so help the children figure things out and to come together and to agree and help Bobby as she tries to cooperate with the children and get the arrangements made. Support them, we pray, and help them. And we come alongside Rex Rice's family as well, and help them, we pray, to celebrate Rex's life and to make the transition after his death. We pray that all that they need would be supplied, and that family, friends, neighbors, and others would gather around to support them and lighten the load. We remember too Tuffy File, his family, as they mourn his passing. We pray that the arrangements for his life celebration would go well, and family and friends would gather to give thanks to you for Tuffy's life and support them, we pray. And we pray also for Jerry Slavin, and ask that you would provide all that's needed in that situation, as well as Mike Cruz's grandson. Pray that what needs to be brought to bear for him would be done. And we pray that family and friends would be available for these folks to gather around and to support and encourage them and to lighten their load. Father, we give thanks along with Judy for the safety of her family as fires threatened, and that you held them back from taking any lives and severely damaging towns. So we appreciate your hand in that, and holding back as you do around the world and throughout the universe. All evil, all threats against us are at within your jurisdiction. You are sovereign over all things, all powers. all good and all evil bows to you. So we do so as well, and thank you for protecting us. We ask also for your protection for ones who will be traveling after the family get-togethers to celebrate Thanksgiving. We pray that their miles would go by safely and pleasantly, and that you would usher all of the family members home safely. And we want to give you thanks for the opportunity to celebrate Thanksgiving. We pray that you're duly appreciated for all the bountiful blessings that you've granted. And we also give you thanks for Advent to prepare for the celebration of your son's birth. And we pray that we'll be mindful of the preparation and mindful also of his great sacrifice to leave your side to come in flesh and endure this earth. And so we give you thanks for that and ask that you would bless our celebrations, that they might duly honor you. Thank you for listening to us. Thank you for being a God that owns and governs the universe and yet wants to hear from little us and cares and delivers on that caring. So we willingly and joyfully present this prayer offering to you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Black Friday, a day after Thanksgiving that many people look forward to each year. Black Friday is known as the beginning of the Christmas shopping season in the U.S., when most retailers open early and even overnight to offer promotional sales. It is the busiest shopping day of the year. The real Black Friday occurred long, long ago, when Jesus died on the cross for our sins. His death on the cross provided a path for our salvation. It gave us an opportunity to have a personal relationship with the one who made us and loves us more than we can imagine. John 14:6, Jesus said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." God doesn't have to offer a big promotion one day a year. His arms are wide open 24/7, 365 days a year. Salvation is not offered at a discount. It's free. Free to everyone. Imagine walking into Walmart and holding out your arms and shouting, "Here I am, what's for free?" Our Savior has already been through the checkout line. Salvation has been paid for. It's free. All we have to do is accept it by making Jesus the center of our lives. If you're here this morning and have accepted Jesus into your heart, we invite you to take communion with us. Deacons will hold the bread and the juice, the bread representing Jesus' broken body, the juice representing his shed blood. Please hold the elements until all are served, and we'll take them together as a church family. Please pray with me. Lord, thank you for all that you bless us with. We thank you, Lord, for the gift of salvation. May we never forget that day when Jesus died on the cross for our sins. We remember him now as we examine our hearts, humble ourselves, and acknowledge that we need him in our lives each and every day. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. Matthew 26:26-28. While they were eating, Jesus took bread. When he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat, this is my body." Then he took a cup. When he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink from it, all of you. This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins." In return, we now have the opportunity to offer the gifts that Jesus gave to us, to those who also need him. Our gifts bless the work of the Lord here at BFCC, as well as the work going on outside of this church. This is a time to give back through our tithes, our time, our talents, to those who are so much in need of knowing him. Please pray with me. Lord, thank you for all that you have blessed us with. Pray we would be good servants and caretakers of all that is yours. I pray we would be cheerful givers as we consider giving back what you first gave to us. Bless these gifts and the giver. In Jesus' name, amen.
Good morning, church.
Good
morning. How you doing today? Doing good? Good. Well, we're glad that you're here this morning. Glad to worship with you. And before we get to our message, I would like to highlight a couple things because there's some important things on the horizon here. Next Sunday, we want you to be aware that we're going to have a potluck meal over in our Family Life Center gym, and it's open for everyone. Doesn't matter if you're a member or not, if you're visiting. We would love to have you at that meal because we think it's a great chance to get to know each other a little bit better. To eat together is always a good thing. And never in the history of the church has anyone ever run out of food at a potluck. So you're pretty safe on coming. If you can bring a dish to share, that's great. If not, we still would love to see you there. After that meal, we will have a time for members to vote. We will have ballots for 2017 nominees for leadership positions, and we will have a proposed budget for 2017. You can actually see both of those out at the Welcome Center. There's a form that shows those ahead of time, so you can be praying about that. But members, we would encourage you to be there next Sunday to vote for those positions and for the budget. Also, want to let you know, 2 weeks from today, December 11th, we will have a special Sunday school Christmas program at 3 o'clock in the afternoon. We encourage you to be there for that. Even if you do not have children in the program, if you want a very practical way in which you can help encourage and support our teachers who every single week are up there and they are working hard to invest kids with the gospel, you can encourage them by coming and being a part of that, just as part of those who would watch and be encouraged by it. It's kind of a neat thing where you get to see children's expressions of worship, how they see God, how they perceive God, and so you'll be blessed, I think, if you come to that. That's 2 weeks from today, 3 o'clock in the afternoon, our Sunday School Christmas program. Then there are other announcements to take note of. When you have time to read through those, we pray you'll do that well. And for now, though, if you would have a Bible, you'll find it helpful if you can follow with me. Genesis chapter 50, verses 15 through 26 is our reading for today. If you don't have a Bible, it's up here on the screen. I'll say this, we say this occasionally, but we mean it all the time, which is if you don't have a Bible, before you leave here today, just let me know and we'll get you a Bible. We have Bibles to give away out at the Welcome Center. We think God's Word is that important. We would love to give you one to keep as your own. Just let us know, and we'd be happy to share that with you. For now, I'm going to read these verses 15 through 26. I'll just give you the quick background. We're wrapping up this series, Thank You for your patience in sticking with us through this long series as we've looked at Jacob, his 12 sons, including his son Joseph, how God has worked in a very dysfunctional family and brought them really to the end of this book, Genesis, but to the end of the lives. We'll read in this section both the death of Jacob, the father, and then we'll also see just before the death of Joseph himself. So it actually covers a long period of time, but in two brief settings. And I'll read this, and then we'll look at what God wants to say to us today. But follow with me, remembering this is God's word. When Joseph's brothers saw that their father was dead, they said, "What if Joseph holds a grudge against us and pays us back for all the wrongs that we did to him?" And so they sent word to Joseph saying, "Your father left these instructions before he died. This is what you are to say to Joseph. I ask you to forgive your brothers the sins and the wrongs they committed in treating you so badly. Now, please forgive the sins of the servants of the God of your father." And when their message came to him, Joseph wept. His brothers then came and threw themselves down before him. "We are your slaves," they said. But Joseph said to them, "Don't be afraid. Am I in the place of God? You intended to harm me, but God intended it for good, to accomplish what is now being done, the saving of many lives. So then, don't be afraid. I will provide for you and your children." And he reassured them and spoke kindly to them. Joseph stayed in Egypt along with all his father's family. He lived 110 years and saw the third generation of Ephraim's children. Also the children of Machir, son of Manasseh, were placed at birth on Joseph's knees. Then Joseph said to his brothers, "I'm about to die, but God will surely come to your aid and take you up out of this land to the land he promised on oath to Abraham and Isaac and Jacob." And Joseph made the Israelites swear on oath and said, "God will surely come to your aid, and then you must carry my bones up from this place." And so Joseph died at the age of 110, and after they embalmed him, he was placed in a coffin in Egypt. Let's pray. Help us, Lord, to hear you. Help us to know you and to be changed. Thank you for your Holy Spirit that is here in this place, moving among us even now. We take great comfort in knowing, God, that you come near to us. And so as we pray to be heard by you, we know that you'll speak because you are good. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. I don't know if you remember this. Probably 3 or 4 years ago, kind of became an internet sensation, I think, of sorts. There's a church in Spain that has a beautiful fresco. It was a painting that was done on a wall. And as you can see from this picture, it was deteriorating. There was moisture that had gotten in, and so the painting was starting to come apart. It was done in the 1930s, and then just 3 or 4 years ago, they realized that, you know, we really need to do something to restore this. And it was an interesting thing because there was a woman who was part of that church who kind of took it upon herself. She decided she was going to restore it, and it didn't really go all that well. Here's how it turned out. And I don't want to be critical, but that's awful right there. I mean, that's just a horrible rendition. And she received a lot of flack. She had a lot of people like, "Oh, this is..." In fact, some people thought the place was vandalized when she first did it. And she's like, "No, I did that. I'm trying to restore this painting." Somebody actually said, "Well, it basically looks like a crayon sketch of a very hairy monkey in an ill-fitting tunic is what it looks like to us." And so you look at it, it's like, wow. She had really, really great intentions. She did. I mean, even to this day, she looks at it as, I tried. I wanted to do something for the church. We didn't need to pay some high, you know, person to come in and try to figure out. I wanted to do this for the church. Her intentions were perfectly good. But intentions are not enough when it comes to you and me. They really aren't. We know that when our ideas are, we want this to happen, we don't often have the power to make it happen. But I want to use intentions here because Joseph brings it up. He actually brought this up before, years before. Joseph brought up the idea that when he first got reunited with his brothers, brothers, your intentions were evil. They were not good. You wanted me out of the way. You wanted to kill me, but instead you sold me off as a slave to Egypt. Your intentions were entirely evil. But I want to tell you, brothers, and he told them at that point, and now he tells them years and years later, I want to tell you about someone else's intentions who are greater, stronger, and cannot be stopped. And that is the intentions of God. Brothers, your intentions were evil for me, but God intended it for good. And when God intends something, when God has intentionality towards us, this is a message today that's pretty simple. It's the words that you've heard many times in different ways, but it really comes back to this truth. God's intentions for you and for me are good. And when we enter in, when we say, God, I won't fight you on this, I want to enter into your intentions, God says, here's the confidence I want you to have that I will, in fact, bring it about. And it won't look like this. It will look good. Now, I say this picture for me because if I'm being honest, can we just be honest? Does it feel like sometimes that's how it's working between us and God? That I know he's good intentions for me, but it kind of feels like this is the way it is. It's still a mess. It still doesn't look good. God, how can your intentions be good when I don't experience that on a day-by-day basis? It doesn't feel like it, at least to me. Let me just point out Joseph for us. We've tried to use Joseph throughout this. Remember, Joseph is not our hero. Joseph is not the moral example of the story. This story is pointing us to the truth of the gospel. And the truth of the gospel starts with the fact that we are messed up. Joseph is a messed up, dysfunctional sinner as much as his brothers are, as much as his dad, Jacob, was. And God takes us as we are, but here's the truth of the gospel. The gospel is not just that you can be forgiven, but that you will be changed. Yes, God gives forgiveness. He offers forgiveness, and that's where we kind of focus our attention on. I can be forgiven in Christ, that's true, but Jesus makes it crystal clear. These two things are joined together. My intention for you, he says, is not just that you're forgiven, but that I change you by the love that forgives you, that you will not be the same person, that in fact you'll be restored, but perfectly, the way that God intended from the beginning. So how does it come out in our text here? Just these two settings, and they happen years apart. Jacob, the father, has just died. Now remember, Jacob had been in the land of Canaan when Joseph was sold into Egypt. His brothers come down. They're reunited. He says, bring dad down. And they do. And they are there for 17 years. Joseph gets to be with his father, Jacob, who he thought he would never see again after being sold into Egypt, for 17 years. And Joseph is second in command over all Egypt. He gets time with his dad, with his brothers as well. All of the family is gathered down into Egypt with Joseph. And for 17 sweet years, Joseph is with his dad. And Joseph, from the very beginning with his brothers, has not taken revenge. He's not tried to pay him back. He's not just said, boy, now that you're down here in Egypt, I've got you. I could do whatever I want to. I'm in power. Instead, he's shown them forgiveness. He's shown them grace. He's acknowledged what they've done is wrong. He's not trying to slide it under the carpet. He's saying, you were wrong in what you did. It's a sin. You sinned against me. You sinned against our dad. You sinned against God in heaven. And yet, here is real forgiveness for you. For 17 years, his brothers are living in that in Egypt. They're experiencing provision. Not only are we forgiven, but Joseph is providing in a time of famine and difficulty everything that we need. And now for years we've been blessed. And now dad dies. Jacob dies. And the first thought that the brothers have is that maybe this was all a mirage. Maybe Joseph has actually been just biding his time. As soon as dad is gone, Joseph is going to turn on us. Maybe that's the only thing that has been holding him back, is that he didn't want to look bad in front of Dad. And so maybe now that Dad's gone, he's going to unleash on us. And the brothers, in this moment of fear, and this is really the issue, the first intention that we want to look at, God has intentions for us that are going to be stronger than our fears. It comes out in this, the brothers are fearful. They've been loved for 17 years, and yet there's still a big question mark to it. A lot of doubt. Maybe Joseph is going to turn on us now. Here's where you wonder, how could that be? How can you be loved, forgiven for all those years, and then in a moment think it's a sham? And yet at the same time, when I'm looking at us, when we bring this back to us, and we say, I asked this in the first service, this will be fun, we'll just do this. How many of you you've accepted Christ as your Savior, you've been walking with Jesus for, let's say, at least 5 years of your life? Just raise your hand. This will be like the wedding thing, you know, who's the last couple that's out there, right? For at least 10 years, you've been walking with Jesus. For 20 years, at least 20 years, you've been walking with Jesus. At least 30 years. At least 40. Wow, that's awesome. We got some people walking with Jesus for, I won't go longer because you'll get mad at me if I go any longer here, but for as many years as you may be walking with Jesus, here's something that's really interesting. Even people who've been at it for 40, 50, 60 years still doubt. We still doubt. We still have those moments where, like, I know God loves me. Good heavens, they say it 1,000 times at church. I come to church, I can't get out of church without somebody telling me how much God loves me. But there are these times, these moments, when inside, maybe you're afraid to say it out loud even. I don't know. I'm not sure. Maybe, I know things have been going okay, but maybe God is just ready. Maybe God has actually reached the point where he said, I have had it with them. They have reached my limit. You can walk with God for a long time. You can experience blessing and forgiveness and provision, and still there are these moments that rise up and say, but what if? And you don't even want to think it out loud, because some of you are like, I don't even want to say that out loud, Cliff, because I'm afraid God's going to zap me with lightning right then. I'm afraid that if I express my doubts in some way, that God is going to turn and be quick to say, aha. In fact, I'm thinking of myself in Joseph's situation. I'd be a little torqued. If for 17 years I've showed these guys, I love you, I've said I've forgiven you 1,000 times, I really have, I'm just glad that we're all together again as a family, and now you guys concoct this story. And if you're like, well, maybe Jacob really did tell him to say this. Oh, they are falling right back into their old patterns of lying and deceit and manipulating, and Joseph sees it. He knows Dad never said this. He knows they're making it up, because why? They are so afraid. And part of me thinks, if I was Joseph, I'd be just torqued at these guys. What is it going to take? What do I have to do? Fine, if that's the way it's going to be. But when we see in Joseph, and he points us now to the true Joseph, which is Christ, how does Jesus respond when you have doubts? Do you ever think, oh, I think he's upset, I think he's mad? What is Joseph's response when he gets word from his brothers that they are doubting the love that he's shown them consistently for 17 years? Does it catch you when you read that with me, that he weeps? He cries? That God, instead of looking at your doubts and your fears as something to just stomp and say, knock it off, I've shown you love for so long, I can't believe that you doubt me, that there is a God who actually hurts. Why? Why does Joseph weep? Isn't it because he knows my brothers are missing out on peace? My brothers are for 17 years wondering if this is real. And I've tried to show them every way possible that this is for real and it's certain. And they're missing out on the love and the peace that I want them to have. Some people really struggle with fear connected to doubt. They think, well, if you're really spiritual, you don't do that sort of thing. Can I just tell you, it was shocking to the world when Mother Teresa passed away. And you look at a woman whose life was dedicated to Christ, and she gave herself up, poured herself out for the poorest of the poor in Calcutta, where she would take in lepers and she would take in the lower caste that no one wanted any parts to do with, and she loved them. And the verses that come to mind from Matthew 25 when Jesus says, I was hungry and you fed me. Mother Teresa is living that example. She did throughout her life. And when she experienced those kinds of profound expressions of the gospel, you think, well, there's somebody. She doesn't doubt. So it shocked the world when her private letters came out after her death. And people are reading their private notes and her kind of diary kind of stuff, and they're reading these things, and it's expressing tremendous doubt. Like, there are days when Mother Teresa isn't even sure if God exists. And you're like, well, how can you possibly, how can you be a Christian and feel that way? She did. And if you're like, well, Cliff, but that's Mother Teresa. If you want a biblical example, can I give you John the Baptist? John the Baptist, who when Jesus first shows up, is the guy who says, hey, this is the one. He is the one you've been waiting for. I'm not even worthy to untie his shoes. Fellas, you got to follow him. He is the one. And not too long later, when John has actually been put into prison, and Jesus doesn't seem to be being this Messiah that he thought he should be, in John's eyes, John sends a messenger from prison to ask Jesus, Jesus, are you really the one? Or should we be like expecting another one? Should we be expecting somebody else? Huge doubts. I'm not even sure Jesus is who I know I proclaimed it, I know I said it, but I'm really wrestling right now to know if this is real. Can I just encourage you this morning that if you're in Christ and you have doubts, that God is not going to respond to you with anger, but very much like Joseph is reflecting the love of God here. I think God actually weeps. And he weeps because he knows how horrible is it to live with a fear where you're not sure that I love you. How horrible must it be to be in doubt and miss out on the blessing of knowing that you are secure in my hands. And he weeps, but then he does something more than that. Joseph also does what? He speaks, don't be afraid. I will provide for you and your children. And he reassured them and spoke to them kindly. Here's a God who's tender and close, and he says, but God, I'm doubting all of the greatness, all the goodness that we sing about, that we talk about. Doesn't that tick you off? Doesn't that make you angry with me? And God brings us close and speaks kindly and reassures us, and he says, I know. I don't want you to miss out, though. So here's this beautiful expression of Joseph of love. And it comes in this moment where they need it the most, where they are vulnerable, and they get it again, another infusion of love. So I know you've heard this. Those of you who've been walking with Jesus 40, 50 years, this is nothing new. But I want to tell you, I don't care if you're walking with Jesus for 100 years. You can't hear this enough. I can't hear this enough. I have to hear it fresh. I have to hear it new. I have to be reassured. I have to know that God is saying, yeah, Cliff, as crazy as it sounds, this love is that secure. And when you hear God say that again, it just brings you back and it says, ah, thank you, God. Alistair McGrath had an aunt. She lived to be in her 80s, and then when she passed, he said it was interesting because she never married. He said she had a love in her life early when she was in her 20s, a young man that she loved, but it ended tragically. And then for the rest of her life, she never had another real relationship, a close relationship, a love relationship. And he said when she passed, they had a picture. She had a picture of this young man from years and years before. Before she passed, she had mentioned why she kept it, because they asked her, why would you keep this? And she mentioned that, well, because when I doubt that I was ever loved, those moments, those days when it feels like, well, I really don't know. Am I really loved in this world? She said, I could look at that picture and I could remember I was really loved by somebody. Can I just tell you that every time that we take communion, this is a picture. This is God's picture to you saying, when you doubt, when you think you're not worth anything, when you think that I'm sick and tired of you and even God has his limits and you've passed them, can I just remind you to look at this picture? Can I remind you to look in my word and hear, yes, you've heard it before. The brothers have heard this before. Hey, I'm going to provide for you and your children. They've heard that 17 years ago. They need to hear it again. Because God's intention to love us is stronger than our fears, stronger than our doubts. Here's another intention of God. This is really one of the greatest lines in all of Scripture where Joseph lays this out for his brothers. He says to them, don't be afraid. Am I in the place of God? That's a good question for each of us this morning, by the way. Am I putting myself in the place of God? You intended to harm me. Here's the intention, but God intended it for good to accomplish what is now being done, the saving of many lives. Now, this is again speaking to his forgiveness. He's saying, I have forgiven you. But notice again what real forgiveness is. Real forgiveness is never, ever pretending that what the person did wasn't as bad as it was. That is not biblical forgiveness. That's delusion, actually. That's trying to pretend to yourself that what they did to me wasn't really so bad, or they had good reasons to do it, blah, 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 blah. The idea behind the Christian idea of real forgiveness has meat to it, has real hold to it. It says, this was wrong, it was sin against me, and Joseph doesn't try to cover that with his brothers. You intended, your whole heart mindset was to hurt me. You did hurt me. You wronged me. But I can forgive you, Joseph says, not because I'm the hero of the story and somehow better morally than all of you lower brothers than mine. Actually, I can forgive you because I'm not in the place of God. And by saying that, what he's really saying is, brothers, don't think that after all these years I didn't learn my lesson too. Because yes, the brothers were torn up with greed and envy and anger and violence, and they had all their sins and their problems. And yes, Dad had his dysfunction too. He kind of pointed to me. I was basically his idol, his false god in his life. He favored me above all else, even above God. And yes, Dad had his struggles. But brothers, I had my struggle too, because I lorded it over you. When Dad gave me the famous coat of many colors, I loved it. I reveled in it. That's why I told you the second dream. Remember that one? I told you the first dream you guys were all going to bow to me. I saw how mad you got. Most people would say, maybe I don't share the next dream. I wanted to share it with you. I couldn't wait to share it with you. Because I have sin. Because I'm messed up. But God humbled me. And all of the hard stuff that God brought into my life or allowed into my life hurt me tremendously, and yet it humbled me instead of hardening me. I didn't get hardened by it, but God in his grace humbled me, and I was able to see, oh God, yes, I have to be changed too. I need your forgiveness too. This is a hard truth, but if I'm struggling to forgive you, it's because that in some way I put myself in the place of God. I have not remembered that I need forgiveness too. I'm not saying every sin has different consequences. That's all true. But on one level, the Bible makes it clear, every sin puts us in the exact same position, a lost sinner. And when I forget that, when I forget to ask the question, am I putting myself in the place of God? If I can't forgive you, it's because I've done that. When I can forgive you, it's only because I remember God has graciously forgiven me. Therefore, brothers, the forgiveness I give you is not my own. It's not something I've created because I'm really good. It's something I've received. How could I not forgive you for the grace that I've received myself? God's intentions are bigger and stronger than the evil that is done to us, which we think defines us. We do. Horrible things happen to us, and suddenly we've stopped being the person I used to be, and now I'm defined by the very pain and suffering that's been brought into my life. That's who I am. And Joseph could easily have said that and thrown it right back at his brothers, because you were the guys that made this happen. But instead, I think the better picture of it is this. Over in Iran, there's this tremendous palace in Iran, and it was actually created in the 1700s. And the architect at that time basically said, what I want to do is create this magnificent palace that has huge floor-to-ceiling mirrors, so that when you come into this place, it's just overwhelming with the light that's reflected and the images that are reflected off of these huge mirrors. So when they imported these mirrors from Paris, France, Unfortunately, when they arrived in Iran, they discovered at that time that every one of the mirrors they had ordered was in one way or another broken. And so the builders thought, well, these are wasted now. We can't use these broken mirrors, and so they tossed them out. The architect comes in. The architect hears what the story is. He says, I want you to gather all of the mirrors. Well, they're all broken. I don't care. I want you to get all of them. He has them all brought together, and then the architect smashes them into even smaller bits, all of them. And then the architect has a plan that these smaller broken bits of the mirrors would now be used in a huge mosaic. And this picture doesn't really do justice to it, but on all the walls and on the ceiling are small pieces of glass that have been put together in a mosaic. And the interesting thing that somebody pointed out was that more light, here's a truth for us this morning, more light can be reflected by broken glass than glass that isn't broken, because you have more surface area that's available for the light to reflect off of. More light can be reflected off of the broken glass. It's actually more brilliant now than what they thought it was going to be originally. And I thought about that for a while, and I thought, well, that's true in a lot of ways. One of the ways is this. Sometimes our lives are all broken by sin. We come to God, we say, oh God, can you work with this? God says, you see what I did with Jacob and his brothers? I can work with you. We're like, okay, great, but it's broken. And we think the first thing that God's going to do is what? Like, be real careful and start gluing these little pieces back together. And the first thing it feels like that happens is what? He just smashes it even more. Wait, God. I thought this was supposed to be a help here. I thought you were supposed to fix the problem. It actually feels like by surrendering my life to you, it's getting worse. It actually feels worse than it was before. God says, I know. But when I break you, it's not to destroy you. It's actually so that your life is going to be able to reflect more of my light than ever was possible before. In your brokenness, I have another plan to remake you, and you will be more beautiful than ever. And this is really the whole idea behind sanctification. The Bible calls it to be sanctified is this process where God says, you're a messed up sinner, I forgive you, my love is now working in your life, and it's powerful enough, my intention is enough to change you, because my intention is to make you into the image of my Son, to remake you, to restore you. Yeah, but God, there's a lot of bad stuff that has happened to me. There's a lot of stuff that has broken me. God says, my intentions are greater than the worst stuff that could possibly happen to you. I will change you. I will remake you, and you'll be beautiful. And by the way, if you're looking for a reason, this is why every Christian looks at anyone, I mean the worst of the worst, in here or out there. And every Christian has this spark of hope in us that says, we never give up on anybody, ever. Oh, they're a lost cause, Cliff. They're a wastebasket. It's over. They are too far gone. And every Christian in us has this spark that God is saying, never, never. I never give up on anybody, because no matter how broken they are, I can take them and I can remake them, because my intentions are stronger than the evil that's been done to you. It does not define you in the light of God's love. Here's the last one. Ultimately, this intention, God's intention for us to remake us into his image, to overcome our fear, our doubt, and the evil done to us, cannot be stopped. This is about as simple as it gets. I'm just saying that God wins. In the end, God's intention wins out for us. Look at what Joseph says. Now, this is even years later. Joseph is about to die. And he says it. He says to his family, I'm about to die. I'll just pause there for a second. Most people don't like it when you start talking about your death. But there's no greater blessing that you can give your family than when you can look your family in the eye and you can say, you know what, I'm going to die. Oh, we don't want, don't, you're such a downer. Don't talk about that stuff. I don't want to hear about that right now. But if you can look at him and say, no, you got to know this. I'm going to die. But I want to tell you that there is God's intention is greater even than death. Death is not going to stop what God's intention in my life is. And it doesn't scare me anymore. Joseph is saying, I'm about to die, but I'm not afraid. I'm not saying he's reveling in it, oh, I just can't wait till I die. He's saying, this is a tremendous fear that happens in the world, but it no longer has control of my life either, because there is a God who is greater than that. One of the greatest things you can do is to be able to talk about your death and express to your family that I have a hope, and it's not based on me. It's a hope that's based on what he's doing in my life. His intention is greater. How does Joseph get to this point? I'm about to die, but God will surely come to your aid. He's talking all about God. My death is not going to be a problem. How did he get to that? Because he's experienced this. He's actually walked with God where he said, you know what I thought? When I was ripped away and I was sold into slavery into Egypt, I thought, well, that's it. That's the end. I've lost my family. I've lost my homeland. I've lost all that I know and love. And now I'm in this foreign land as a slave, no less. It's over. Yet God was with me. And amazingly, God took me even as a slave and raised me to a high level of a slave so that I was my master's steward. I oversaw everything in his house, Potiphar's house. It was amazing how God was able to overcome that. And then the bottom dropped out. I was falsely accused. I was thrown into prison. And yet God was with me. And amazingly, God was able to take me even as a prisoner and raise me to a status in the prison where I oversaw the prison, even though I was still in prison myself. God was with me. And then I helped some guy in prison, and I told him, please remember me when you get out. I need help. I'm in here. I shouldn't be in here. Don't forget me. And of course, every day I'm waiting for some kind of help to come, and none comes. For 2 years, this guy forgot about me. And I bottomed out again, and I thought, that's it. I'm going to rot to death in prison. And yet God was with me. And God used that very man 2 years later to have a connection with Pharaoh, such that Pharaoh called me out, and I got raised, and God raised me to second highest over all Egypt. And then my family that I never thought I'd see again shows up, you brothers, out of nowhere. Oh, what a mix of emotions. And am I going to make it through this? Can I give forgiveness? Can I get past this anger, resentment? What's going to happen? And yet God was with me, and he raised me up, and he gave me forgiveness, and he showed me how being with me all those years was to change me. And I love you, brothers, and I'm glad I was back. And I thought, well, I wonder if Dad in his old age can make it down here. I'd love to see my dad. And Dad did. And for 17 sweet years, I was able to be with Dad again. And then Dad died. But God was with me, because before Dad died, he passed on, hey, there's a promise that this God has given us, an oath, a vow, which is what? An intention. God intends to give us this promised land. Dad, we're in Egypt. I know, nevertheless, God intends to give it to us. Pass this blessing on. Pass this promise on, Joseph. And when you have it in your heart, it won't matter what you face, because you know that this God, his intentions are bigger even than death, such that Joseph says these incredible words. God will surely come to your aid and take you up out of this land to the land he promised on oath to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And Joseph made the Israelites swear an oath and said, God will surely come to your aid, and then you must carry my bones up from this place. Like, what is that about? You realize he's expressing what we proclaim, which is the truth, the hope of the resurrection, that Jesus has broken the power of death, that those who are in him, even though we die, yet shall live. And we say, there is a hope that I will participate fully in all of God's intentions to come, even though I physically die. He's saying, hey, fellas, brothers, family, take my bones. It's a sign. I'm not going to miss out on anything that God is doing. I know this is a really hard time of year, because at Thanksgiving and Christmas, we remember loved ones that are no longer with us, and when you sit around that table and you're like, that's their place, that's where they should be, and you remember them, and it hurts. Of course it does. We grieve as Christians. but we grieve with hope. And I get this picture, and I believe this is entirely biblical, that we will, in fact, one day, because the kingdom of God is described in many ways, but one of them is a banquet. It's a banquet feast. It's a table. It's the biggest spread ever. And nobody's stuck in the kitchen. That's the best thing about it. You're all around this table, and we're eating together, and it's this picture of the family, and I have no doubt in my mind that all of our loved ones who are in Christ will not only be there, we will be enjoying fellowship with them, the greatest reunion ever. But here's the one thing that I hadn't really thought about before. They will not be just as we remembered them. They won't be. They will be better because they will be complete. That part of us, you know, as family, you get to see this in your loved ones. You see the kernel of goodness in them, and sometimes it's wrapped in crankiness and nastiness, and you're like, I know they look terrible right now, but I know them. I see the part of them. It's the kernel in them that God created, and he said, my intention is not to let that go, but that not even death will stop it. In fact, on the other side of death, you will see the completion of the renovation project that God intends. And they will not be less of who you remembered them to be. They will be all that you have known them to be. God will complete this in them, and that's what will make the celebration great. Not just that we get to see them again, but they will truly do what the scriptures say, that they will shine like the sun, that the Son of God has invested in his life into them so that now they shine in his righteousness, in his goodness, in everything good about them that you got just caught glimpses of in this life is fulfilled completely because he says, that's my intention, and nothing will stop it. Nothing, including death. And Joseph says, I'm going to die, but I will not miss out on anything. Because in God's kingdom, this much is true. I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor whatever may come in the future, nor any powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus, our Lord. Let's pray. What can we say, Lord? We are just grateful. You intend for us the greatest possible good. And yes, we doubt it. There are days it doesn't seem like it could ever really happen. But God, thank you that we can trust you, that we can know you, that we can be reassured by you, that you come close to us and you speak these words that we've heard before, but today's a different day and we need to hear them again. And so we pray, God, that we would be quick to look into your word and so we could hear you regularly, to worship you with all of our heart and soul so that we would know you and that this hope that we speak of isn't just something in our head, but it sinks down to our hearts. So God, we cling to your hope that you give to us. We cling to this promise that you will remake us. And then for this great reunion, God, to be in your family around your table, we give thanks that no matter what happens in this life, God, that intention will come true. We love you, we worship you for that. And for all that you do for us, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Keep worshiping here. We're going to have this closing song, but if you need prayer, actually, I'm not going to be available back there for prayer. I'm going to do a baptism here in just a second. But if you need prayer, hang around after. We would love to pray with you. Otherwise, would you stand and let's worship our God. He is worthy today.
For all the blessings that I cannot see.
Excited. Anytime someone expresses a desire for baptism, and we have Gus and Emma Rice with us this morning. They've expressed a desire to be baptized, and the reason that's exciting for us is because that is in response to a command that Jesus has given his followers. When he gave the Great Commission, he said, go make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I've commanded you. So when we see this happen, we know it's a God thing. And so we're always excited by that. And for us, baptism is a sign of that reality, that the Holy Spirit has come into the heart of someone who has accepted him, received his work of righteousness on their behalf. And so it's also a chance for us then to hear that statement of faith, that confession of faith. So for us, all that's required for baptism is not a height limit or not an age limit. It all comes down to this. Can someone understand enough what Jesus has done for them to express their faith in him? And so we only have one question, and I'm going to start with you, Emma, because you're closest here. And the question is this. Have you accepted Jesus as your Lord and Savior?
Yes.
Wonderful. Well, then this is appropriate for us to baptize you. So I baptize you in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. So we get to ask us the same question. The same question is this. Have you accepted Jesus as your Lord and Savior?
Yes.
Wonderful. Excellent. That's a good confession of faith. That means we are happy to baptize you in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. We're going to pray for them. The first reaction is to bolt after you get baptized. That's okay. That's part of the deal. But we are so glad for you guys, and we want to pray because we want you to remember your baptism in years to come, what God's doing in your life, okay? Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you. You are good. You give new life, and you provide everything that we need to live in that life. We pray, Lord, for Gus and for Emma, that you would give them your grace in every day, every battle, every situation they face, God, that your intentions for them would be stronger. We pray, God, that you would protect them in every spiritual battle that they will face, that your Holy Spirit would empower them using gifts and talents that you've given them, that they would be able to glorify you
to honor your church and to work within the body of believers in every way. God, would you bless them? And on those days where it's dark and difficult and doubts abound, that they would remember this moment, baptism, that reminds them that you live within them. And I pray, God, that they'll never forget that even now as we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. 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 Have a great week this week. Thank you.